dark funds.
Who frequents the hotel area, Chilton, Mr. Carter?
No, he's all right. We'll carry on here.
As you wish, sir.
Oh, and another brandy. Well, let's talk about you, Harper. Do you know any of the people in Seacombe?
That's one of the Paris networks, isn't it?
Yes. We think it's possible that the Germans have penetrated Seacombe.
Gestapo or SD?
We're not sure, but the indications are that it's the SD.
Well, what do you want me to do?
Well, we'd like you to look them over and let us know what you think.
You want me to take over Seagull?
No. We don't want you to have any contact with them. Just carry out a surveillance.
How do I report back to you?
We'll give you your own wireless operator.
Experience?
Just finished training. First class.
French or English?
Bilingual, let's go. Oh.
How old?
23.
Where is he now?
He's a girl. You can interview her as soon as you like.
Is there an alternative?
Possibly. Why?
She's too young.
Wait till you've seen her, Harmer. Then we can talk again. I'd like you to go to Bewley and give a few talks to the SOE trainees. There's a cottage there available for you until the operation. You can interview her there.
And if you want to give yourself away, behave as if you were trained here. So, don't look around to see if you're being followed. And if you are stopped in a check, don't hurry to get your documents out. Have the reason already in your mind as to why you are where you are, but don't give more information than you need. Don't be friendly or try to charm them. They're too used to resentment and obstruction to fall for that, and they'd be all the more suspicious. Right. Any questions?
Who normally carries out the checks?
The Gestapo, the SD, the Fell Gendarmerie, and on rare occasions, the Abwehr.
What authority do they have to arrest?
Mainly Lugers, I should think.
Quite right, Miss Fraser, thank you. Well, you've got 10 minutes break now. Report back to the projection theatre and you'll be shown the current newsreels. Tonight, you will have individual interrogations on your training cover stories. Be well prepared, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, and there'll be no evening passes tonight.
Oh, no.
Have you spoken to the girl yet?
No, but I'm worried about her.
Why?
Well, she's too pretty. And she's a bit wild. I cancelled her evening passes tonight, and she looked like she could happily kill me. Every night she's off to the West End or Southampton to parties and nightclubs.
Well, so are some of the men.
Yes, I know, but how do I control her in Paris? It won't only be Frenchmen. She'll be attracted to the Germans and she won't know how to handle them.
Arma, she never breathes a word about what she's doing. We've checked on her over and over again.
Right, well, I'll let you know what I think when I talk to her. Well, Jean Fraser, tell me about yourself. You're bilingual, I understand.
Mon père est un avocat et ma mère est française. Je suis fille unique.
Good. Okay, we'll continue in English, shall we? Is your father successful?
Yes. He's well known in Edinburgh. He gets more work than he can handle.
Is he rich?
Well off. He doesn't discuss money with me.
Why'd you join the SOE?
They asked me, and it sounded fun.
Fun?
Yes, fun. May I ask about your background?
Very well. My father is a retired insurance agent and he helps my mother run a boarding house at Sea Houses in Northumberland.
What did you do before the war?
I was a shop assistant.
What kind of shop?
A bookshop.
They told me that I was being considered by an agent as his WT operator. It's you, isn't it?
What makes you think that?
You wouldn't be talking to me if it wasn't for that. You wouldn't waste 5 minutes of your precious time on me. Because you only like humble people. And people who take life seriously.
I should certainly be scared of working with someone who thought fighting Germans was fun.
Well, you look at my record, mister. I've beaten most of the men on this damn training course, and that's what counts.
Why do you spend so much time in nightclubs?
Because I like nightclubs, and I like nightclub people. They're happy. They have a good time. They enjoy themselves. So put that in my P-file.
It's already in your P-file.
I can't win against you lot.
Well, you know what they say.
Time spent in reconnaissance is seldom wasted.
It's true.
I'd better go.
You don't want to be my WT operator, then?
But you just said...
I was just discussing the problems with you.
But you're prejudiced against me already.
I'm prejudiced both ways.
What's that mean?
You've got a first-class training record, so I want to take you on while I've got the chance. But on the other hand, there are a couple of snags.
What are they?
Well, first of all, you're very beautiful. You're too beautiful. You'll be noticed wherever you go, by Germans as well as Frenchmen. And secondly, I'm worried about the nightclub business. The only people in Paris nightclubs are Germans and black market barons, and that's dangerous for you, and therefore dangerous for the rest of us.
You don't like me because maybe my father's wealthy, and you don't like me because I don't take life seriously. Am I right?
Perhaps.
Okay, I'll make a bargain with you. You take me, and I'll never go near a nightclub unless you order me to.
Why are you so anxious to go on this mission?
I suppose it's in the blood. I loved my time in Paris. I belonged there. It was terrible to think of the Germans there. It's like men in hobnail boots treading on roses. I want to help throw them out.
You know we'll be dropping blind. No reception committees, no safe houses, no contacts. It's more dangerous than a normal network operation.
Well, I didn't know. But if that's what we're expected to do, I'll do it. I won't be a liability.
Think about it overnight. Tell me in the morning.
Are you going to think about it?
No.
Why not?
I've already decided. If you still want to go after you've thought about it, I'll take you.
Can I tell you something?
Mm-hmm.
You know, in your own sweet way, you're just as much of a snob as you think I am.
How'd you make that out?
Well, you said you worked as a shop assistant.
Yeah, well, that's true.
Yes, but a bookshop's different. Much posher than just a shop. Yours is a sort of inverted snobbery.
Maybe you're right.
Well, thank you for listening. I've done some notes on my talk, and there are copies in the office for those who want them. Are there any questions?
Which are the most efficient, the Gestapo or the SD?
Well, they're both efficient, but fortunately for us, they're bitter rivals. Not only in France, but in Germany, too.
How does that help us?
Well, they don't compare notes. They don't share their records or the results of their interrogations. There's no cross-referencing, and they spend a lot of time and energy disparaging one another's information.
Which of them is best at interrogations?
Ah, they both get results. The SD men are generally more intelligent and better trained. The Gestapo are mainly low-grade. They recruit on a different basis to the SD. They're not too fussy about background, rely more on brute force than brains. But they're effective. They go for violence in interrogations, but the SD tend to get more information. That's probably the main difference between them. The SD want to know. The Gestapo want to chalk up an arrest.
What's the best attitude to adopt for interrogations?
Well, it's tougher for us than it is for a normal prisoner of war. A serviceman gives his name, rank and number, quotes the Geneva Convention and refuses to answer any other questions. Those are his orders, and they know it. For us, we are being interrogated as suspect civilians. You've got to stick to your cover story through thick and thin. You've had plenty of experience from the mock interrogations here, though you probably feel that the instructors were pretty rough. Well, believe me, they were as gentle as lambs compared with the real thing. And what's more, you know that they're instructors. They may have yanked you out of bed in the middle of the night, they may have used some violence on you, but they're men you know. You've eaten with them in a mess. You don't need me to tell you that it all feels a lot different when it's for real. If you stick to the basic rules you've been given, that's all we ask. You stick to your cover story as long as you can. And no matter what, don't talk for 48 hours so that your network has time to disperse. Oh, and one last thing. It's not a rule and nobody demands it of you, but even when they've broken your story, you don't have to tell them more than you need to. Make them work for it. It takes more than average guts, so it's just a thought, not a rule, and certainly not an order.
You'd better read that.
What is it?
My operational orders. Read it aloud and you'll remember it better.
For Captain James Harmer, organizer of Cyclops. Operation Instruction Number F65, Operation Cyclops. Field name, Archevêque. Name on papers, Jacques Hubert. 1. Information. You have been briefed on the personnel and the objectives of existing network Seagull, and you have been informed of our concern that this network may be insecure. You have agreed to carry out a surveillance of this network and report your findings to London. 2. Intention. A. You will return to the field accompanied by your WT operator during the February moon. B. Your party will, for security reasons, drop blind in the area Imonville. C. You have been given details of RV and safe houses currently held by Seagull personnel. These will not be used by your team. D. You have been given the address of a safe house in Chartres to be used only in an emergency. The password there is Audubon. E. You will not make contact with any member of Seagull, nor attempt any active operation. F. Decisions regarding transmissions are entirely at the discretion of your WT operator. 3. Administration and finance. You will take with you to the field 300,000 francs, and it is expected that this will be sufficient for a period of 6 months. There's no signature.
Are you worried, Jane?
I'm something. I don't know what it is.
Try and tell me.
Well, I don't seem to belong anywhere anymore. My parents in Edinburgh seem like the other side of the world. I feel as if I've already left Bewley. And we don't belong here anymore. And we don't belong where we're going either. I can't believe I'll ever belong anywhere ever again. And I'm scared.
What are you scared of?
Everything. I'm scared of the drop. I feel that just being dropped is enough. And to go on doing things after that to cause trouble seems crazy.
Everybody feels like that.
Do you?
Well, I did the first time. I just wanted to go back and have my bacon and eggs with the aircrew. They looked so much as if they belonged together. They were going back to proper beds and a routine they knew. I had no idea what I was going to face. And when I was brought back here from my network in Lyon, I felt the same. I wanted to stay where I knew the rules. I still feel an imposter in this battle dress.
What sort of place did you live in Lyon?
Oh, I was never very long in the same place. My main base was in an attic. I rather like that.
You're a funny man. You really are.
In what way?
I know so much about you. I know things about you that I suspect you don't know yourself. But really, I know nothing about you. Absolutely nothing. When exactly do we go?
I don't know the exact date, but we'll be here for Christmas and the New Year anyway. I'll fix leave for you if you want. You're entitled to 3 weeks when you finish the course.
And what will you do for Christmas?
I'll stay here.
But everybody will be away.
So?
Why don't you go to your home?
Well, there's only my parents.
But there'll be parties to go to. The conquering hero on leave and all that.
They think I'm a rifleman in the infantry.
They want to see you all the same.
No, it's not that kind of family. They've got their own worries.
You're their son, for God's sake.
You wouldn't understand.
But don't you want to see them?
Not really. I've got my routine, they've got theirs.
How about you come up to my folks for a few days at Christmas?
Huh? No, I'd be in the way.
Don't talk rot. You're a friend of mine, that's enough.
That's very kind of you. I'd be very grateful.
Great. I'll phone my folks tomorrow. You know, when this wretched war is over, we'll have to send you on a training course to get your house trained and civilised. You're a bloody zombie, Captain Harmer, sir. I'd better get back to my billet now.
I'll walk you back.
He seems a nice laddie, your James.
I'm allowed to call him Jamie when we're off duty. What do you think of him?
I'd say he was a bit on the quiet side for you, my girl.
Reserved is the word. He is a bit on the dry side. But if you'd seen his parents, you'd understand why.
Have you met them?
Yes, we called in on the way up here. We were only there for an hour, but it seemed like an eternity.
Tell me more.
Well, there was no welcome for him. You'd have thought he was a stranger. They just sat there like statues, impatient for us to go. No kisses or hugs, nothing.
Ah, well. He looks the kind of fellow who will survive.
Who's going to survive?
We were talking about Jenny's friend, Captain Harmer.
Ah, And what was the verdict?
Jenny was saying that his parents were not very responsive, unemotional people.
You're fond of him, aren't you, Jenny?
Yes, Daddy. I suppose I am.
Tell me why.
He was a very successful leader of one of the networks in France. He's very brave, and he's quite good-looking. But he's got no background, no support. Nobody who cares about him. And he's totally honest.
And you feel you can supply what's missing?
I'm not sure that I can get through that suit of armor that he wears. I'm not even sure that I'm the right one to try.
Sounds to me like pity rather than affection. Is it?
A bit of both, I suppose.
Well, that's not a bad mixture, young woman. But don't rush things or you might get yourself hurt.
Well, that's part of what loving someone's all about.
What is?
Risking getting hurt yourself.
Well, now, changing the subject. Is everything ready for our busy day tomorrow? I don't know how we will squeeze them all in, but we always seem to manage it.
Oh, I'm warm. Come with me, I've got something for you.
Huh?
Well, put it on, you goose. If you've already got a better watch, they'll change it.
Dearest my own.
It's beautiful, Jenny. It's far too good.
Of course it's not.
I've got some for you too, but it's in my room.
What is it?
I'll go and fetch it.
No, don't. Give it to me tomorrow. But tell me what it is.
Well, it's nothing much.
Tell me, Jenny. What is it?
Honestly, it's not very exciting.
Please tell me.
It's the Oxford Book of French Verse.
How lovely. When did you get it?
When we were shopping in Princess Street yesterday.
You're a thoughtful man, my Jamie.
Am I your Jamie?
Let's wait till this war is over, then we'll know.
I shouldn't have asked that. I apologize.
Oh, Jamie, don't be so modest, self-effacing. You're very special, Jamie Harmer, and don't you forget it.
Bother with any of that tonight. Mrs. McLean's coming in at 7 tomorrow with her daughter. They'll cope with all of that. Have a last whiskey, Hector.
I've already had 2 last whiskies, my dear. Here's the bell of the ball. Did you both enjoy yourselves, sweetie?
That's a nice thing to say, both of us. Makes us sound like a proper couple.
I saw him glaring at all the boys who kiss you under the mistletoe.
He didn't do too badly under the mistletoe himself. I told the girls to make sure he got his fair share, and they didn't need any persuading.
Oh, he grows on you, that young man got his values sorted out. I had a long chat with him after lunch, and I was very impressed. But I'm still surprised that he appeals to you, young lady. I can't see any Captain James Harmer spending any time in the Embassy Club or anywhere of that ilk.
Our Janie will probably convert him. She may be your little sweetie, but she is a doughty little fighter, aren't you, my love?
When I want to be. Are we there, Janie?
Yes. Back from the fairy story to reality. Did you have a good sleep?
Lovely, thanks. Did you really enjoy Christmas?
You know I did. I loved every minute of it.
Why was it a fairy story?
Oh, people with open minds. And generosity. Open and welcoming to a stranger just because he's a friend of one other family.
Most families are like that, Jamie.
Maybe. I've arranged for us both to do a few jumps at Ringway, just to tidy up.
I've done all my jumps. I'm past.
Well, the report said you had untidy landings.
Did it?
Yeah, it doesn't matter in training, but it does in the operation. Remember, we're on our own. No network resources to back us up. If you broke an ankle, we'd be in terrible trouble.
Right, just let me check your harness, miss. Right, is that comfortable?
Yes, that's fine.
Right, now you, sir. Right, now who's jumping first, sir?
The young lady.
Right, then. In position, get comfortable. Now, don't worry about your face hitting the other side, love. It's further away than you think. It's over 6 foot. that when I tap your shoulder, straighten your back. When I tap you the second time, you go. Understand?
Yes.
And don't forget what your mother told you.
What's that?
Always keep your legs closed.
Don't need any of that sort of talk, Sergeant.
No, sir. But right, miss. Back straight. Good. Go!
Beautiful wine, Jamie. You must be impressed with your parachute badge.
I was pretty impressed by your parachute jumps myself.
Thanks. Why don't you have some? Just a drop.
Oh, all right, then.
Last time I saw Paris. Listen, they're playing our tune. Dance with me, Jamie, just this once.
I can't dance, Proly, you know that. I can't dance at all.
Didn't do badly at Christmas. In fact, you danced perfectly well. Have a go. I'll guide you round. Come on.
And lovers walk beneath the tree, and birds find songs to sing. All right, let's go over it once again.
We land and bury our parachutes in the ditch. I walk to the road as soon as it's light. 2 kilometers further on, there's a bus stop at the main road. The first bus is a 5:20 local time. I go on the bus to Chartres and take a ticket to Paris, a return ticket. There's a train at 2 p.m., and you will catch that when you see me get on it. We travel separately. If there's a check, I use my documents and my cover story. We join up outside the station in Paris.
Why are you on the train?
I've had the promise of a job in Paris with a photographer. I've got a letter from his studio.
Fine. Any queries?
What did they check on the studio address?
Oh, it's a genuine studio, and the man whose name is on the letter would confirm that the letter was genuine. He's one of ours.
Is it still to be tomorrow night?
Unless there's an unexpected change in the weather. If you do have second thoughts, you can change your mind any time before we board the aircraft, and nobody would hold it against you. There are plenty of vacancies in SOE in England for wireless operators.
We're a team now, Jamie, you and me. I shan't be backing out.
Try and get a good long sleep in tonight.
I'm going to check over my radio again.
Good girl.
I had my final dental today.
Oh, what have they done?
Taken out 2 good English fillings and put in rather nasty continental fillings. Look.
Oh, you still look very beautiful.
Thanks. By the way, what happens tomorrow?
Well, we fly out from Thamesford near Luton in a Dakota. And Carter and a Fanny officer for you do the clearance check.
What's that?
Check that we take nothing with us apart from what we're given. All personal stuff we have to leave behind. Check that our clothes are genuine French clothes. They give us all our documents. We shower and they clip our nails, fingers and toes. They tell us we can back out if we want to. And they wish us good luck.
Sounds grim. By the way, how do they get genuine French clothes?
The interrogation centre for French refugees buy them in exchange for clothing coupons.
They're very efficient, aren't they?
They have to be.
The little town of Cassino is being steadily and swiftly blown to pieces. We've done everything possible to dislodge the enemy, but he is determined to stand
Mr. Harmer? Yes? So Flight Lieutenant McNay. There's a wee bit of cloud over the French coast, but that won't be any problem. The weather over the other side is much the same as here, damp but mild. Are you both ready to go?
Anytime.
Come on then, let's get cracking.
Another 10 minutes, Skipper. There's not much wind now, so we can drop you pretty accurately. What's the jumping order?
Me first, then the girl.
Right. The red light will go on 3 minutes before our ETA.
Right.
When it's light, I catch the 2 p.m. to Paris and wait outside the station for you. You'll be traveling separately on the same train.
Okay. On your way. Take care. Well, we made it, girl.
I can hardly believe it.
Why?
It was so easy.
If it isn't easy, you don't make it.
But only two checks the whole way.
Yeah, we were lucky. The train from Chartres was crowded and the police were in a hurry. I think I'll see if we can get rooms here.
Monsieur, mademoiselle, the food to your satisfaction?
Oh, fine, thanks, Petro.
Ah, bon.
Where can we rent a couple of rooms?
How long for?
6 months, maybe longer.
Just the two of you?
Yes.
Well, there's a large double room upstairs with its own kitchen, but only a shared bathroom.
Can I say it?
Well, of course. Through the door first left, up these stairs to the top floor.
What's the reception going to be like up here?
It'll do.
Now, how soon can you contact London?
Well, I can take a 9 o'clock schedule tonight if you want it.
Right. I just need to let them know where we are.
Is it?
Le patron.
Come in. What is it, monsieur?
There is a man to see you.
One man?
Just a man.
No, I don't know anyone round here. It must be a mistake.
If you want my help, you will help this man.
What kind of help?
He's in danger. He wants your help. Others want your help. They are desperate.
What's that got to do with me?
I think you know, my friend. He's waiting in my own room.
I'll be down in a few minutes. Who are you, and what do you want?
Do you like seagulls?
Tell me about seagulls.
We're in trouble, real trouble.
Tell me, what's happened?
We've got Francois, the wireless operator.
Who have?
Our friends in the Rue de Sorcery. The Gestapo.
When did they pick them up?
2 days ago.
Did London know?
We've no way to tell them. There's no other operator.
Did they get the radio?
Yes.
Were they transmitting at the time?
God knows.
Have the rest of you moved out?
We've no money, and there's nowhere for us to go.
Right. Can you contact them quickly?
Well, of course.
Here's 10,000 francs. Contact all of them. They're to leave wherever they are now, immediately, in seconds, not minutes. Tell them to meet me at the cafe in the Rue Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Hurry! Don't waste time. Did you get through to London?
Yes.
Any response?
They told me to stand by. They came through 10 minutes ago. I've decoded the reply.
Read it.
Archebec figures 1094. You will break off all contact with Seagull Network immediately.
What?
Confirm next transmission, stop. Your orders were specific and your duties limited to observation without contact, stop. Details of arrest noted, stop. Message ends, figures 1094.
They just don't understand. These people are demoralized. They'd be rounded up in days if they were left to their own devices. When's the next transmission?
Tomorrow evening at 8:07.
There's no emergency time we can use?
Well, they didn't give us an emergency schedule after our first transmission.
Why the hell don't they want me to take over?
I don't know, Jamie. Why did they send us at all?
They wanted a check on their security. They were afraid they'd been penetrated.
Plenty of networks have collapsed before. What's so special about Seagull?
What makes you think it's special?
They pulled you back from leading a successful network. Did they give you any secret orders to do something apart from the surveillance? You wouldn't tell me even if they had, would you?
I suppose not.
Do you want us to leave here tonight?
If I did that, they'd be finished. I told Pierre I'd talk to them. I was sure London would agree. Listen, I've got to go to the cafe. I'll be back as soon as I can. Was there anything planned for the next few days, Martin?
No. There was to be a planning meeting. We'd been having problems with London.
What kind of problems?
They seemed to be cool about everything that we were doing. And they refused us a drop.
What had you asked for?
Plastic detonators and pencil fuses. Nothing special.
Mm.
And they kept delaying decisions on our targets.
What was the wireless traffic in the previous 2 or 3 days?
Francois sent a message that if they didn't agree target soon, we should go ahead independently. Baker Street signaled that he was possibly going to be recalled to London and to contact the air transport organizer. But meanwhile, all operations were to stop. 2 days later, Francois was picked up.
What targets have you suggested?
The locomotives at Evreux and the power station at Nanterre.
All right. Let's go over to the others. Right, gentlemen. Unless anyone else would like to do so, I shall now take over this network.
Fine by me, yes.
Very well. We'll carry out the sabotage operation at Evreux when I've looked at the target. Who's done the check on the locomotive sheds?
Me, Albert.
And how many locomotives are actually inside the shed?
For the next 2 nights, there will be 3, possibly 4. One under repair, one for routine servicing, and the others for change of crew and route.
How are they guarded?
The sheds don't have a separate guard. There's a patrol at night. Mm. 6 Wehrmacht men and a sergeant. Unless there are troop trains or supply trains coming through, it is all very casual. But there are 2 anti-aircraft guns in the park across the road from the station. They've got full crews, and they're on standby every night because of the RAF.
Are any SNCF men around at night?
The night repair crew has just 2 men.
Oh. Yeah. Do they have a break?
2. 15 minutes at midnight and an hour between 3 and 4.
And where do they go?
They rest in the waiting room on the platform.
Do the guards use dogs?
No. I've never seen any there.
All right. Any other information you can give us?
There will be 4 trains through tonight. None of them stopping, but they distract the guards.
Have you done locos before out there?
No, just the tracks.
But you've used plaster before.
Oh, yes, many times.
Where were you trained?
Sabotage at Hartford. And the rest at Bewley and Scotland.
Right. We'll just do the locomotive cylinders. Right side only. That's all it needs. 1 hour fuses.
Right.
When we leave, we don't go towards Paris. We go west on the Conche Road. Get bicycles for all of us. We'll fix an RV, and one of you can wait with the cycles until we come. We'll cycle back, and Albert, you can stay and come back later and tell us what you've seen.
Right.
What happens now?
I must explain to Baker Street what's going on. There's a planned operation to carry out. Perhaps that'll convince them. After that, I can get these people out of Paris to somewhere safer. They deserve that, at least.
You sure you're not holding something back from me?
Like what?
That the surveillance is just a cover for something else. Oh, Jamie, thank God.
Hello.
How did it go?
It went well. They're brave lads, and they carried out their orders perfectly. We've put those locos out of action for at least 6 weeks.
Well, they won't be transporting any troops for a while.
Maybe London will take the point when they get our report.
Write out your signal, I'll code it and send it off. And you get some sleep. You look worn out. Jamie, wake up.
Mm.
Martin's waiting to see you. He's downstairs.
Mm. Did you get a reply from London?
Yes, but you won't like it, Jamie.
Read it to me.
Personal to Archevêque, stop. You will cease all contact with Siegel Network, stop.
What?
You and WT operator will proceed immediately to Perpignan Safe House and use escape line Patricia to Spain, stop. Message ends.
They're out of their minds. I don't believe it.
What are you going to do, Jamie?
Send them this. Your message not understood. Stop. Network cooperating fully and successfully. Stop. Request further operational instructions. Stop. How long before you can send it?
About an hour. 63 minutes.
I'll go down and see what Martin wants.
Jane? What the hell's the matter, Jane?
Nothing. Why?
You look like you've seen a ghost.
They ordered me to stand by after I sent your message. When they came back, they said they would no longer accept any signals traffic from us. I just went off air. I sent her emergency signal 3 times, but they didn't respond.
Look, I've got to go out again. There's something I have to do.
Be careful.
I'll be back soon.
Jane!
Who the hell are you?
My name is Klugman. Hauptmann Klugman. No, don't move. One of my men is outside, and there are 2 others now at the bottom of the stairs. You're wondering, no doubt, where the girl is. She's in our safe hands, my friend. And so is your radio, and the rest of your network is being arrested right now. Walk down the stairs, nice and slowly. What's your real name, Archivik? What do they call you back at Baker Street? Why did they send you to Seagull? Why did they feed you into the mincing machine when they knew we had Seagull in our hands? Somebody in London must really dislike you. I'd better hand you over to my rough friends in the basement.
Where in hell is this?
This is hell, my friend. They call it Buchenwald. They call it Buchenwald.
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 Yesterday morning at 2:41 a.m. at General Eisenhower's headquarters, General Jodl, the representative of the German High Command, and of Grand Admiral Dönitz, the designated head of the German state, signed the act of unconditional surrender of all German land, sea, and air.
A visitor for you, Captain Harmer. But I don't want him put under any kind of pressure, Mr. Carter.
No, of course not, Doctor. Just a chat.
Hello, James. It's good to see you. Just popped in to see if there's anything you want. Anything we can do for you?
Without any news about Jane Fraser. Any of the others?
We'll talk about that when you come out. Got plenty to read?
Tell me what you found out.
Well, it's not good news, I'm afraid. In fact, it's almost no news. There's no trace of any of the network. Most of them were captured, but what happened to them, we don't know.
Jane?
She was sent to one of the concentration camps. That's vital. The girls who were sent there are now classified as missing, believed dead. I'm very sorry, James.
What happened? Why was it such a shambles? What went wrong?
I really don't know. Part of the pressures before D-Day. Forget it, James. All of it. We've all got to get on with our civilian lives.
Welcome to Coronation London, this city transformed by excitement and joy and loyalty, the true center this June morning of the emotions of the whole wide Commonwealth, and of our friends and our allies as well. And here, before Buckingham Palace, Her Majesty's London home is the right place to begin our rejoicing. And to warm our hearts as we wait for Her Majesty, we've got the news of the conquest of Mount Everest, a glorious coronation gift for the Queen.
Chief Superintendent Harmer.
James, we're making up a party to go to see the King and I at Drury Lane on Saturday. We've got a spare ticket. The boys and their wives would like you to come.
Well, you know me. I'm not one for social events.
Count it as a duty, James. A morale booster. They really would appreciate it.
You'd make a good blackmailer, Joe. Okay, I'll come.
Good. Unless you know the details, you might even enjoy it.
Taxi! Are you coming on with us to the nightclub, James?
No, thanks. I'd best be off now or I'll miss my last train.
Radio.
It's been a very enjoyable evening, Joe. Thanks again.
Jane?
Jane Fraser?
Hello, James. What are you doing here?
What are you doing here?
Does it matter?
They told me you were dead.
As you see, I'm not.
I thought you were dead. What happened to you? Where did they take you?
They sent me to a concentration camp. Natzweiler.
Look, could we go somewhere to talk? It's kind of odd standing here asking questions after all these years.
We can go to my place.
Will that be all right?
Why shouldn't it be?
I mean, are you married or anything?
Why'd you ask?
Just wondered if we'd be able to talk properly.
A good practical reason.
You didn't answer my question.
No, I'm not married or anything.
Where do you live?
In a little Mews flat in Kensington.
Have you got a job?
Yes. Translate novels for publishers.
Oh. Are you sure it's all right if I come back to your place?
Oh, James, don't be so Victorian. We used to... Yes, it'll be all right. Make yourself comfortable.
Thanks.
What are you doing now, James?
Guess.
I've no idea. Schoolmaster?
I'm a policeman.
Of course. How right.
Kent County Constabulary.
You must be very good at it.
Maybe.
When did you get back?
Well, I was released from Buchenwald late 45, but I was in hospital for quite a time. What about you?
I was back quite quickly. June 45.
Why the hell didn't they tell me?
I expect they had their reasons.
I heard that MI6 got busy destroying all records and traces of SOE as early as 45. I wonder what happened to the others.
Pierre is a juge d'instruction in Paris. Beaucaire plays the piano in a nightclub. Martin works here in London at Rothschild's.
Oh.
Albert is in an asylum just outside Paris. He never recovered. You didn't meet Francois and his radio girl. They both died in Fresnes prison under interrogation. But you probably know that.
I've not heard a word about any of them.
Are you married, James?
No. Have you seen any of the Seagull people since the war?
Yes, I've seen them all.
What?
Those that survived.
Lately?
We meet if we can once a year.
But how do you all get in touch with each other?
We were all debriefed in London. We kept in touch.
Who debriefed you?
Carter.
Oh. And what's Carter doing now?
He's a director of Coutard's, the merchant bankers.
Uh-huh. Does he go to the reunions?
No. He's not been invited.
Well, why wasn't I invited?
Nobody knew that you were still alive.
I'd like to meet them just once again. Who should I contact?
I shouldn't contact any of them, James. It wouldn't be wise.
Why not?
They think the network was betrayed to the Germans.
Oh, I think they're probably right. What's that got to do with me?
They think it was you.
Me? And what do you think?
I keep an open mind.
Is that the best you can do?
I'm afraid so.
But you were with me all the time. I was arrested too.
You disobeyed London's orders.
But you were there. You saw what it was like. I couldn't leave those people to be picked up by the Germans.
They were picked up after you took over. Can I ask you a couple of questions, James?
Maybe you won't believe the answers.
I shall. One of them I ask solely because you always did speak the truth.
Go on.
On one of the last days, when London were being difficult, I asked you if maybe the surveillance wasn't a cover for something else. You didn't answer in words, you just shook your head. Was that because you knew something the rest of us didn't know, but you didn't want to tell me a lie?
I can remember you asking that. Remember shaking my head.
Maybe I had something else on my mind. I meant exactly what I indicated, that it wasn't a cover. There was nothing it could cover. So what's the other question?
On the morning of the day we were picked up, you went out. You didn't tell me where you were going, and I was arrested before you came back. Where had you been?
I went out to buy you an engagement ring. I got it from a man in the Rue Mouffetard. Second hand. Gold with a small diamond.
Oh, God. What have they done to us all? It's wonderful to see you again, Jamie. I thought about you so often.
I thought about you, too. I tried not to, because it upset me. I bought a gramophone record of the last time I saw Paris to remind me of when we danced that night after the parachute dropped.
I think it's best if we don't talk about those days. Maybe sometime, but not now.
I can't believe that the others think I betrayed them.
Does it really matter after all this time?
Well, it matters to me, and maybe it does to them. It must have mattered to you to feel that you'd gone through all that because the network was betrayed by me or somebody else. Why did they suspect me?
I think as people talked and compared notes, they felt that the Germans seemed to know too much.
Well, why not Francois or the WT operator? They were arrested days before.
They both died under interrogation. If they had talked, that wouldn't have happened. They would have sent them to camps. There were all sorts of unexplained bits and pieces. And you were at loggerheads with London. That seemed very odd.
But only you and I knew that.
Oh, Carter hinted at it in the debriefings. It was implied that if you had not disobeyed orders, all would have been well.
Bastard.
He didn't say so. It was just vaguely implied.
Maybe I should contact Carter, see what he knows.
Don't do that, Jamie. He won't help you.
Why not?
My impression was that he did think it was you. It was a bloody mess, and that was the only explanation. And they were glad to leave it like that. An unsolved mystery that was best forgotten.
Where did you have the reunions?
In Paris. The first time was at the cafe where you and I lived. But it upset me. And we went to Le Lapin the other times.
I've never been back. I never wanted to. I never imagined I'd want to go to Germany either.
Hello? Hello?
Hello. Jim, it's me. James.
James, where are you?
I'm in Hamburg. I've traced Klugman. The Gestapo man who interrogated me.
Where? What's he doing now?
Well, apparently he lives in Amsterdam. He's a successful car dealer. I'm going to talk to him, see what I can find out.
Maybe he won't talk.
Maybe he will.
Of course. The price is negotiable, but...
It isn't the car I want to talk about.
And what do you want to talk about?
You don't remember me.
We do have a lot of English and Irish people interested in our cars. I try to remember faces, but I'm afraid that I don't always succeed.
I'm thinking of way back, say, 1945.
That would be very unlikely, Mr. Fraser. I was in the army at that time.
Not quite the army, was it, Herr Klugman?
Who are you? Your name is not Fraser, is it?
No, it's Harmer. But when you and I met in 1944, you knew me under another name.
And what was that?
My code name was Arshavec. My field name was Hubert, Jacques Hubert. You interrogated me at the Gestapo building in Paris.
I make no secret of being a German, Mr. Harmer, yeah? I fought for my country as you did for yours.
I'm not too interested in what you did, Herr Klugman. I'm only interested in what I did.
I don't understand.
Do you remember the Seagull Network?
Of course. I was responsible for the arrest. It was the most successful operation we had in 1944.
What sort of information did you have on Seagull before you arrested Francois and the wireless operator?
Let me think. I can remember that we knew of a safe house in one of the small streets off the Rue de Varennes, Oh, I can't remember its name. We had a good description of Francois, nothing much beyond that. But in the 2 weeks before we picked up Francois and the wireless operator, the SOE signals traffic was very insecure. In the last few weeks, they were ridiculously insecure.
In what way?
Addresses given instead of code names. A couple of references to operations that were sufficiently explicit for us to work them out. Our signals people said it indicated unusual pressure.
Were Seagull under that much pressure?
No, it wasn't Seagull who was insecure. It was London.
What? You mean signals from London actually gave addresses of safe houses?
Yes. We spent hours and days trying to work out what London were up to. We thought it must be a trap, you know, a radio game.
How did you find out where we were?
Oh, somebody, I think maybe one of the cryptographers, did a check on the signals traffic of your old network. What was it called? The
curfew.
Ah, that's it. And that was the breakthrough. There was a signal from London warning them to have no contact with you, but it gave you a location at the cafe.
You mean its code name or its actual name?
The actual name and the arrondissement. I don't think it gave the street, but that was no problem.
I don't believe it, Klugman.
What don't you believe?
That they gave away my location.
We all thought it was a bit odd, but everything had got a bit odd about Seagull. We got the DF vans and set them up to check your wireless traffic. You tried two or three times to contact London, but they didn't come back to you. We checked to see if they were responding to other networks, and they were. That made us suspicious.
What did you suspect?
Ah, God knows. But the whole Seagull affair had become suspect. Nothing added up. It looked like London were deliberately throwing them all away, and you too.
So, what did you decide?
Oh, we left it to Berlin. They came back in about 2 days and told us to round up Seagull and you and the girl.
Are you telling the truth when you say that Francois and his operator didn't talk?
They didn't talk, I assure you.
Was there a traitor among our network?
Absolutely not. In fact, we were rather sorry for you all. Everybody held out, more or less. But you got no support from London. If it hadn't been for their insecurity, we probably wouldn't have got any of you. I tell you, their lack of elementary signal security in the last 2 weeks would have got them court-martialed if they'd been on our side.
When did you get back from Amsterdam?
4 days ago.
Why didn't you contact me sooner?
Let me tell you. I talked with Klugman.
What did he say?
He said that London gave us away.
What?
They passed signals to my old network and other groups that said in clear where we were. London threw us away, Jane. And I know who it must have been.
Who?
Carter. It all fits in now. I know what the German told me.
We'd never be able to prove it, Jamie.
Well, I'm not interested in proving it. Carter's going to tell me.
He wouldn't dare tell you. And anyway, he might just have been carrying out orders.
He'll tell me, and no honorable man would carry out such orders. I've been checking up on him in the last few days. I know where he lives, and he's got a young girl in a flat in Fulham. She'll be the stakeout. I'll get on my way then. Oh. Tell me just one thing, You didn't really believe it was me, did you?
Not really, Jamie. It just didn't fit.
Take care of yourself.
Yes?
Oh, good evening, miss. I'm a police officer. My car's broken down. I'd be very grateful if you'd let me use your phone. I won't be more than a couple of minutes.
Got any identification?
Of course.
Okay, you better come in.
Thanks.
Who is it?
It's a policeman, Monty. Wants to use my phone.
Shan't be a moment, sir. Just a call to transport.
Oh, that's all right. Harmer.
Huh?
My God, James Harmer. How are you?
I'm sorry, I don't think we...
Carter? Well, I'm blessed. I'm fine. How are you?
Very well. Never been better, old chap. And you're a copper now.
Uh-huh.
Bet you're a damn good one. Where are you stationed?
Maidstone. Detective Chief Superintendent. Kent County Constabulary.
Well done, well done. This is a friend of mine, Penny Watkins.
Hello.
How do you do? She's my part-time secretary. Look, I tell you what, make your call, old boy, and then let's go round the corner and have a pint for old Lang Syne.
Why not?
So how's life treating you?
Don't get a moment's relaxation. The bank takes every minute. One damn thing after another.
Why don't you take some time off?
Oh, you could have my boat on the Medway.
What?
Yeah.
You know, that's a pretty good idea. I'd like to take you up on that. I could take young Penny.
Sure.
Yeah. So do you really mean it?
Yeah, of course I do. Well, why not come down on Friday evening, stay till Sunday? You might as well enjoy the last of the summer.
Right, well, scribble your phone number out for me. Yeah. I'll phone you tomorrow.
Morning, Carter. Brought you a Sunday paper.
Hello, James. Thank you.
Where's the young lady?
Oh, I took her to the station this morning. She'd had enough of peace and quiet.
You know, I never knew your Christian name.
Monty.
Ah.
Montague Rayner, those are the prefixes. A drink, old boy? Or is it too early for you?
Why'd you send me to Paris, Monty?
Huh? Sorry, what do you think?
All those years ago, why did you send me to Paris?
What the hell are you on about? What is this, an interrogation? You know damn well why you were sent to Paris. You had orders, you were briefed, you had documentation.
Go on.
Well, there isn't any more, old boy. They picked you up and that was an end of it.
Why did they pick me up?
Well, God knows. You must know why better than I do.
Well, I don't think so, Monty.
What do you mean?
What exactly did you send me to do?
Well, what did your orders say?
To keep the Seagull network under surveillance and report to London.
Exactly.
Why did you close down the wireless on me?
Because you were endangering Seagull and you were disobeying orders.
Seagull's wireless operator and leader were arrested before I got to Paris. The rest would have been inside a week.
Well, they were in a matter of days anyway, even with you in charge.
Who told them where we were? Who gave them the safe house addresses?
How the hell should I know? You were there. Who do you think told them?
I think you told them.
Oh, my God, this is ridiculous. I'll have to report all this, you know.
Why did you give safe house addresses instead of code names in your signals?
We didn't know where you were, Harmer, so we couldn't have done that.
I'm talking about the Seagull safe houses, not mine.
You never saw Seagull radio traffic. Their operator was arrested the day before you arrived.
Answer me, Monty.
Why? I don't have to listen to all this rubbish.
You did do it. The Germans told me so.
No, they were bluffing. Trying to break you down.
Oh, they didn't tell me then. The case officer told me a few days ago. I'm going to kill you, Carter, unless you tell me what I want to know.
Oh, for God's sake. It was policy. Nothing to do with me.
Go on.
There was a vital network working between Paris and Cherbourg. They were in a special team sent over to prepare for D-Day, right in the landing area. We had to keep the Germans off their backs. We shoved the crowds a bit towards Seagull to keep them occupied and away from the others.
How many lives did betraying Seagull save?
God knows. I'm not a bloody soldier.
So why did you send me?
To check what was happening. We would have withdrawn you after the Seagull people had been taken if you hadn't interfered.
And because I interfered, you threw me and the girl to the Gestapo along with the others.
Nobody was thrown away. You came back for God's sake. You're alive. You've done well.
Who worked all this out?
I was told to give protection to the Penguin Circuit. That was the only way.
Have you ever thought about what happened to all of us?
Of course I have. It's very much to be regretted. It was a necessity of war.
Do you remember a man with a field name, Albert?
No.
He's in a French asylum. Been there ever since the war.
Oh, come on, Jimmy. Join me in a drink. It was all a long time ago and best forgotten.
I don't drink.
Oh, now look, Jimmy.
What do you make of it, Keating?
Almost certainly murdered, Chief Inspector.
How?
Ah, that's why I said almost certainly murdered, but not where he was found. There's a whole series of broken blood vessels down the right side. Oh, that occurred after death, probably when the body was thrown down. There are typical signs of asphyxia, a pinpoint hemorrhaging in the eyes and under the scalp.
Strangled?
No, there are no marks of strangling, but what there is a massive bruising under the left ear. Someone has applied enormous pressure there. More than just normal pressure from a finger or thumb. It's a nerve pressure point. And I'd say he died in 5 to 15 seconds. Certainly not longer.
Could the pressure have been applied by a blow from something?
No. A blow from anything would have had to break open the skin to apply that kind of force. I'd say it was pressure from a thumb or knuckle, applied by a man with special knowledge.
What kind of special knowledge?
He'd need to know that pressure applied at that precise point could kill a man.
You mean a doctor?
Could be. An osteopath? A vet, even. A wrestler.
When shall I get your report?
Preliminary, midday today. Full report in about 3 days.
Driving license valid until 30th of November, 58. Name M.R. Carter. Address 49 Kings Avenue, Wimbledon. Membership card, Cockatoo Club. No dates, no name. Pigskin wallet worn. Containing 2 £5 notes, 2 £10 notes, 3 £10 shilling notes. Photograph of man and woman in garden. 2 joined half tickets for the Aldwych Theatre. 9 visiting card, M.R. Carter. Director, Coulthard's Bank, London and Singapore. Photograph approximately 2¼ inches square of naked girl. Mm-hmm. Wristwatch, Rolex chronometer, black leather strap. Plain card with various notes in pencil and ink. Looks like directions. Finger ring, 1 diamond, 18 karat gold. A 6-packet of Durex, 2 missing. Parker 51 pen, metallic blue. Checkbook, Barclays Bank, 2 checks used. Wimbledon High Street branch. And that's it. Well, you better check that Wimbledon address, Phillips.
On my way, sir. I'd just like to go over your statement one more time, Mrs. Carter. You said that your husband told you that he'd be away for the weekend, staying with an old army friend.
That's right.
Did he give you an address?
Well, there wasn't an address. They were staying on a boat.
And what was his friend's name, Mrs. Carter?
I think it was Harper, a name like that.
And where was the boat?
I don't remember.
The Medway?
I don't think it was mentioned.
What did he take with him?
A case.
What size case?
A weekend case.
And you've not heard from him since?
Yes, as I said in my statement, he phoned me on the Saturday about midday.
Did he say where he was phoning from?
No, but it was a reverse charge. The operator said a call box in Maidenhead.
In Maidenhead?
Is that wrong?
Could it have been Maidstone?
Oh, yes, it could.
What did he say?
Nothing much. He was having a pleasant, restful time with his friend, and he'd be back about 8 or 9 on Sunday evening.
And that was the last you heard from him?
Yes.
Is that a photograph of your husband?
Yes, that's my husband. You found him, haven't you?
I'm afraid we have.
Where is he?
Maidstone Hospital.
Does that mean he's still alive?
There's been an autopsy. Are you alone here, Mrs. Carter?
Yes.
Have you a relation or friend who could come over?
Only my sister.
Where does she live?
In Putney.
Is she on the telephone?
Yes. My phone book's on the hall table. Her name's Mary. Mary Fielding.
Well, you sit there. I'll call her.
Is it all right with you to start, Mr. Rose?
By all means.
First of all, let me say, Miss Watkins, that we appreciate you coming forward. We'll keep you out of it as far as we can. Now, you say in your statement that you recognized the photograph of the deceased in the newspaper. You contacted your solicitor, Mr. Rose, here, and made the statement. You state that you knew Mr. Carter over a period of nearly 3 years. How old were you when you first met him?
17.
Right. Now, your statement ends where he invited you to stay for one night with him on a boat. Can you describe the boat and where it was?
It was near a village called Yolding, moored near a caravan site. I could take you there. The boat was quite big, wooden. And the main part was painted white with a blue line.
Do you know who? Belong to?
To a friend of Monty's.
Do you remember this friend's name?
No, but I'd know it if I heard it again.
Can you describe him?
He was quite a big man, nearly 6 foot tall, reddish hair, a nice man.
Was the friend on the boat all the time?
Oh, no. He was just there on the first evening for about 10 minutes, showing Monty where the things were, the gas and so on.
Were they on good terms?
Oh, yes, they were very friendly.
They knew one another well?
Yes, from the war.
Where did the friend live?
Somewhere round about Maidstone.
How do you know that?
He said so.
Any idea what sort of job he had?
He was a policeman.
How do you know that?
He said he was. He and Monty hadn't seen each other for years, and his car broke down outside my flat when Monty happened to be there. He used my phone to ring Scotland Yard for help, and then he and Monty went out for a drink.
How old was he, approximately?
A bit younger than Monty.
Between, say, 40, 45?
Yes.
Did he say what rank he was?
Can you tell me some?
Oh, constable, sergeant, inspector, superintendent?
That's it. Superintendent.
You're quite sure that when he phoned Scotland Yard, he said superintendent?
Yes.
Did any help come for his car?
Yes, I saw a squad car from the window after he left.
Did he say what he was doing to be near your flat?
I don't think so. I can't really remember.
I want you to think very carefully. Back to that phone call to Scotland Yard. Try and remember anything you can. Don't hurry.
I can't remember anymore.
Fair enough. Now, I just want to go back to the name. You're sure you can't remember the name?
No, I can't remember it. But I think I'd know it if I heard it again.
Was it Phillips?
No.
Harmer?
Yes, that was it, Harmer.
You're quite sure that was the name?
Yes, absolutely sure.
Mr. Rose, would you have any objection to your client making a signed statement now at Chelsea Police Station?
Provided that no information on her statement is given to the media, I would have no objection.
Put me through to Detective Inspector Phillips.
Yes, sir. Phillips here.
Hale's here.
Yes, sir.
Take two of my men on one side and put them on around-the-clock surveillance of Detective Chief Superintendent Harmer. Full time. Do you understand?
No, sir.
Well, just do as I say. I'll explain when I see you.
You're sure about this, sir?
Yes, I wish I weren't. But there's still a long way to go.
Right, sir.
It just doesn't fit, Frank. Jimmy Armour's an experienced detective. If he wanted to knock somebody off, he wouldn't leave all that stuff around.
No.
There's been no effort to conceal anything, not even the body. He'd know that it was only a matter of time before it was found. He'll know that the girl can witness that he knew Carter and that Carter had been on his boat.
Yeah, right.
But he hadn't even seen Carter for years. He only met him by chance. What the hell motive is there?
Well, maybe we'd better ask Jimmy Harmer himself.
Not bloody likely. I'm going to talk to the chief constable and the yard before I go near him.
Well, the evidence against him doesn't amount to much. You can prove opportunity, but that's all. No evidence of motive or anything to connect him to the killing. Could have been somebody else.
Exactly. But now that we've got a suspect, Keating can start looking at it all over again.
I don't think you stand a chance in court, Chief Inspector.
It's the only real lead I have, sir.
Too bad.
But if I could question him, I could probably get a lot more.
You mean charge him and then question
him? No. Just ask him to answer a few questions to assist my inquiry.
What do you think, Grover? You're the legal eagle.
Well, there's no reason why the chief superintendent shouldn't answer questions to help an inquiry. He'll probably say that he knew Carter, lent him his boat, and that's it. There's nothing to connect him further.
There is, sir.
What?
Harmer will have seen the papers or listened to the news. He must know about Carter's death. Why hasn't he contacted Maidstone?
Maybe he hasn't read the papers or listened to the news. You said he was off sick, so he may be confined to his bed.
And why hasn't he been to the boat since the Sunday morning visit? Surely he'd want to check that they'd left it shipshape and safe, and surely he'd contact Carter about the weekend. Did he enjoy himself and all that?
I agree, that would be the normal pattern, but it doesn't mean anything in court terms. And like I said, he may still be confined to bed.
How are you feeling, sir? Any better?
I'm Chief Inspector Hales. I'd like to ask you some questions, if I may. Tell me what happened. Was it an accident? You're a policeman, same as me. Don't make it difficult for us both. When did you last see Carter? Look, I don't want to do it, but if you don't answer my questions, I'm going to have to take you into Maidstone and question you there. Formally. James Harmer, I am a police officer, and I am making inquiries into the death of Montague Rayner Carter. I believe you can help me with my inquiries, and I must ask you to accompany me and Detective Inspector Phillips to Maidstone Police Station.
It's Chief Constable and Chief Inspector Hales, Mr. Armour. Just walk in.
Ah, yes. Would you sit down, Chief Superintendent? Is there anything I can do for you, James? They tell me that you have refused to answer even routine questions. Would you like to see a doctor? Would you like to talk to me off the record? The chief inspector is investigating a murder, and it seems that you knew the victim and that he was last seen on your boat. I would like to ask if anything untoward happened that you know of. Carry on, Hales.
James Harmer, I arrest you on suspicion of the murder of Montague Rayner Carter on or about the 28th of September, 1953. Anything you say may be written down.
Press the bell when you finish, Mr. Fraser.
Well, it's good to see you, Jamie. You're in this godforsaken place. First of all, let me tell you about Jane. She only discovered what had happened a couple of days ago. She was very distressed. As you know, she thinks the world of you. She sent for me to see what could be done. Would you talk with me?
Yes. I'll talk to you.
Jane thinks she knows why this happened. I'm not going to talk about it in any detail in this place, but I can say that I think there would be an excellent defense if Jane's theory were correct. You understand what I mean? Jane told me most of what happened both recently and back in the war days. I understand your feelings, and I think there are others would understand, too. Mother and I were always very fond of you, right from that Christmas, way back. Money for top counsel would be no problem. I've got far more than I shall ever need. Jane is already well provided for. So, please, can I help you?
Well, you never prove what they did. There'll be no records. They'll have destroyed them long ago. Nobody would admit what had been done to us.
We could subpoena anybody you felt might have information.
And they wouldn't talk. They'd just sell me down the river again.
All of them?
There was probably only one other involved.
Do you know who he was?
No idea. But whoever it was, he wouldn't talk. They wouldn't let him.
A good cross-examiner could prise it out of him.
They'd hide behind the Official Secrets Act.
They would make your point for you.
Oh, no, they'd see to that. They threw us all away once. They'd throw me away now. They don't really have any choice.
Why did they do it, Jamie?
To distract the Germans from another SOE network that was preparing for the D-Day landings.
Why not say this in court?
Who would believe me? I haven't any evidence. I wouldn't have known myself if I hadn't forced it out of Carter.
He must have felt terrible when he had to do that.
He didn't care. He tried to justify it. It was an order, so he just carried it out.
What can I do for you?
Take care of Jane. Tell her I cared. I just couldn't bear to think what he'd done to us all.
There's still a chance they may acquit you.
I don't care what they do. I squared things off, and that's what mattered. But in the end, I couldn't bring myself to run away.
Would you like Jane to come and see you?
No. She'll understand why not.
Read the indictment.
Yes, my lord. James Harmer, you are accused of the murder of Montague Rayner Carter on or about the 28th day of September in the year of our Lord 1953. How do you answer?
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I am afraid that at this point it is necessary for me to explain a point of law to you. When a defendant does not reply to questions that are legally and correctly put to him, the court has to decide between two issues. Is the defendant what is called in law mute of malice, that is to say, able to speak, but refusing to do so? Or is he mute by visitation of God, that is to say, temporarily or permanently unable to speak? There is no doubt in my mind that the defendant stands mute of malice. The second point that I want to draw your attention to is that the court has appointed learned counsel to act as what we call amicus curiae, the friend of the court, to act on behalf of the defendant. And the learned counsel who has been appointed raised no objection to my finding that the defendant stands mute of malice. The defendant has not spoken or responded to questions from the moment of his arrest. And this leads me to my final point. I want you to know that it is a matter of law that a defendant has the right to remain silent. During the trial, and when you retire to consider your verdict, you will not read into the defendant's silence any implication of guilt. Guilt is for the prosecution to try and establish, and for you alone to decide.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, it is the prosecution's intention to put before you evidence that will convince you that the defendant committed the act of murder on the deceased Montague Carter. But before I come to that evidence, there is something that I want to bring to your attention. The occupation of the accused. He is a very senior police officer, a detective chief superintendent of the Kent County Constabulary, no less. It is my duty to point out to you that that has no bearing on this case. You may feel that a senior police officer is either less or more likely to commit the crime of murder, but the defendant in any murder trial is a man or a woman, nothing more. He or she may be titled, eminent, famous, or otherwise virtuous, but when he stands in the dock in this court, he has to be considered as innocent until you decide that he is guilty. Turning now to the evidence that I will put before you, I start with the finding of the body. On the afternoon of the 10th of March, a sales representative came upon a body lying in a wood near the village of Yalding.
in Kent.
You are Penelope Margaret Watkins, and you live at 27A Bedford Street, Notting Hill. Is that correct?
Yes.
How long had you known the deceased?
Nearly 3 years.
You had a very close relationship with him?
I slept with him.
Ah, yes. And you and the deceased went down to Yalding on the evening of the 26th of September, a Friday?
Yes.
Right. And you also met another man at that time, the owner of the boat?
Yes.
Can you see him in this court?
Yes, he's a man sitting between the two policemen.
I see. Did you see much of that man during the weekend?
No. He was there for a short time when we arrived, and then he left.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, when this trial started, his lordship instructed us on the subject of the defendant's silence. He told us that such silence should not be interpreted as guilt. Now, I want to remind you of that. It is the defendant's right not to answer questions. It is as much his right as any other right granted by the law. And when his lordship warned you that no guilt should be attached to that silence, he meant no guilt, not even the smallest prejudice. The defendant is exercising such a right in remaining silent in this court. Exercising that right makes him neither innocent nor guilty. It leaves him a neutral status. Now, my learned friend representing the Crown told you that the Crown does not need to establish motive, and that is perfectly true. However, the absence of evidence on motive is significant. Now, there are usually only two reasons why such evidence is not put forward. The first is that although the motive is known or suspected or patently obvious, it cannot be proved. The second reason can be that there is no motive on the part of the defendant for the simple reason that he or she did not commit the crime. Now, I won't dwell on this, but I don't want you to be misled by my learned friend's comments on motive. If the Crown could have put forward motive, I have no doubt they would have done so. I come now to the evidence which the Crown has put before you. It strikes me as being like one of those boxes of chocolates called assortments. Try this strawberry cream. And if you don't like that, try the marshmallow. And if you don't fancy that, then there's always the one with the nut. There was a little something for everybody and nothing much for anybody. And when it came to establishing that a murder had been committed, we heard the evidence of an eminent forensic scientist. But in my opinion, that merely established the cause of death. I suggest to you, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, that the Crown did not establish that murder was committed. And when we listen to the parade of those who the Crown suggests would have the necessary strength and knowledge to commit such a murder, we are indeed in a very strange company. Wrestlers, surgeons, veterinary surgeons, I won't go on. But you will notice that detective chief superintendents were not on that list.
I come then to the character of the defendant. You have heard his superiors, his colleagues, and his juniors testify that he is an excellent police officer, doing his job with impartiality and skill, with respect for the public and the law. However, I must point out to you that we are not considering here whether detective chief superintendents of police are capable of committing murder, but whether this particular man, the defendant, has committed murder on the evidence put before you. There are no difficult points of law for me to explain to you. This is not what is sometimes called a judge's case, bristling with intricate points of law. It is very much a jury case, where your own common sense will be most important. You will be taken by the bailiff to your jury room, and your foreman will notify the bailiff when you are ready to give your verdict.
What do you feel?
I'm damned if I know. It was a messy trial.
That couldn't be helped.
So, why did you bring it to trial?
My masters wanted it. Mine but to do and die.
How long do you think they'll be out?
If it's over a couple of hours, they'll find him guilty. Have you picked up any tittle-tattle as to why he wouldn't talk?
No, not a thing. He hasn't said a word to me.
That must have been pretty frustrating.
No, not really. It's just another case, as far as I'm concerned.
Mr. Foreman of the jury, do you find the defendant guilty or not guilty?
Not guilty.
Is that the verdict of you all?
It is.
Have a whiskey with me, Jeannie. It'll help you get to sleep.
I don't like whiskey, Father. You know that.
Doesn't matter. Have one with me just to celebrate.
You're a cunning man, you know.
Well, that's wisdom, not cunning. What's worrying you, girl?
I've been tempted to phone him. He must feel terribly lonely and deserted.
Oh, I think you're probably right.
You mean I should phone him?
No. I mean that he will be feeling lonely and deserted. But not deserted by you. Much as you loved him, I'm sure that by now you're only a postscript in his life.
I don't understand.
He was always lonely. He was a lonely boy. He had a lonely childhood without warmth and affection. He was a lonely young man. Then came the war, and he did a job that absolutely fitted him. People wouldn't have described him then as lonely. There was a more romantic word. He was a loner. It was loners who survived in that sort of work. I met you, and I suspect that you were the only person in all his life that he ever felt love for. And then he was betrayed. You all were. Some of you came back. Some of you survived better than others. Some just existed, like the man you told me about in the asylum. Somebody high up decided that a handful of people should be thrown to the wolves. Nobody will ever know if it was justified. One man, your Jamie, would never see it as justified. His kind of people don't do things like that for any reason. To find that his kind of people did and thought nothing of it would be almost worse than the things you all suffered in the camps. To him, what he did, if he did it, will have been far more than just squaring the account. To him, they used his loneliness, his courage, and then threw him away. And the rest of you with him. Takes a different kind of courage to face up to that. He hasn't got that kind of courage. That kind of courage comes from having self-confidence, friends, and a background. He never had that.
So what do I do?
For him or for you?
For him.
Nothing. You leave him alone. That's what he chose when he first set out to confront Carter. He knew what he was doing. And he'll know what he's going to do now. He's that kind of man.
And for me?
I suggest you close down your flat and come back here where you're loved and cherished. Keep on your translations and read Victorian novels.
Why Victorian novels?
Because in those days women found it possible to love just one man in a lifetime. If he didn't come back from the wars, they went on loving him. And no other.
I wish Janie was being loved and cherished.
It's too late for that, my love. That has to start when you're a child.
You're a wise old bird. And I'm terribly glad I've got you and Mother.
I'm not all that wise. I'm much the same as your Jamie. I'm a black and white man. I don't believe in the grey bits. It's not popular these days. But it means I know where I am. And so does he.
Vous billets, s'il vous plaît. Merci, monsieur.
Pardon, monsieur. À quelle heure arrivons-nous à Paris?
À 6h30. Bonjour, monsieur.
Good evening. You still rent rooms?
Of course. How long for?
Just the night.
Uh-huh. Haven't I seen you before?
The room.
Oh. There are two rooms up these stairs. Take your choice. Pay me later. Here's the keys.
And now cricket. England's team for the second test match, starting in Sydney tomorrow, will be Hutton, Bailey, May, Graveney, Cowdery, Edrich, Evans, Tyson, Wardle, Statham and Bedser. And news has just come in that the senior police officer found not guilty in a recent murder trial has been found dead in a small hotel in Paris. No further details are available.
The last time I saw Paris, her heart was warm and gay. No matter how they changed her, I'll remember her.
In The Lonely Margins by Ted Albury, Christian Rodsker played Harmer, Kim Thompson, Jane, Ian Cuthbertson, Mr. Fraser, and John Badley, Carter. Carl Deering was Klugman, Simon Cuff, the defense QC, Stephen Rashbrook, the prosecution QC, Alan Dudley, the chief constable, Caroline Gruber, Miss Watkins, Norman Bird, the judge, Eva Stewart, Mrs. Fraser and Mrs. Carter, Stephen Harold, Pierre, Lawrence Payne, Inspector Hales, Michael Tudor Barnes, Inspector Phillips, John Sampson,